get anything much more beautiful than this where we are right now. It's magic. It changes all the time. We've had everything from dramatic 360 degree sunsets to teeming rain when you can't even see Gulaga Mountain.
Back in 2007-2008 we started up a statewide monitoring program for the estuaries, and we mainly focused on water quality. And Tilba Tilba was actually on our list of lakes to go and visit first up. And what we found was that that Tilba actually performed quite poorly. It was actually the worst for its type of lake in the state. When you actually looked at Google Earth and you went up and down the state looking at the coastal estuaries, what stood out was that Tilba was a large lake that actually had no riparian vegetation around it. The catchment has been developed for beef grazing for many years. Back, I think they did logging, and then it became beef country back in the 1850s. And most of the lake foreshores have actually been owned by property owners. And people wanted to make it as productive as they thought they best could. And that meant actually getting as much grassland as they could to feed their cattle.
The shorelines were a lot sandier, and that now it's just all silt. Like build up, but you go to go prawning there now, and you know you're up past your knee deep in mud. So yeah, it's horrible, and it smells bad too.
We're driving up to one of the troughs that we've recently put in as part of the program to fence the creek off and to put water troughs in every paddock, which they didn't have. There was only a couple of dams, and not every paddock had water in it or permanent water in it. So when we bought Myrtle Vale in 2017, the cattle were in the creek, in Victoria Creek, which is one of the main creeks that comes from Mount Dromedary. That was their access to drinking water. That is unsustainable. That is environmental damage. They don't know any different. We have to provide something better for both them and then the environment.
I basically cold call people, went to see them and asked them if they'd be interested. We have funding to fund the materials for fencing, and we asked landholders to pay for the establishment of fences. And I would say about 95% of people that landholders I approach are actually very keen, and they've put projects on ground. So the main aim really was to improve water quality. And so to do that, the main thing and the easy thing you can do really is just to get stock out of waterways. So it's often as simple as just putting a fence up to improve water quality. But even better than that, if you improve your riparian zone, you're creating this fantastic buffer that buffers all off-stream, all off-farm nutrients and catches it. Some plants actually absorb it in the riparian zone, and just generally improves water quality.
One of the most polluted lakes within the state, which is pretty sad considering it's an area that as a young child I remember going to prawning with my father and uncles and stuff like that, and they knew a lot of the landholders and stuff like that and had access to it back then, and that was one of the favoured prawning spots.
Through the local land services, actually got onto the landholders to actually see if we can do some regeneration work, which like plant a lot of trees in there, and hopefully it'll filter out the catchment on its way into the river system, into Tilba Lake, and hopefully it actually improves the water quality over a lot of years, but we're hoping it actually does the job. So
I certainly agree with fencing off the lake edge, having seen what the cows did to it that we had as guests, and what happened once we took them out. That's been a virtual miracle.
In reality, there has been few studies. It's quite rare to get a community on board to actually adopt some practices like fencing and re-establishing the riparian buffer, and then having an opportunity to also to monitor that progress in terms of seeing whether or not the benefits that people are expecting, whether or not you're actually seeing that in the empirical data that we're collecting as part of the monitoring program.
It's extremely important to have other agencies involved. I mean, it's very uncommon for any of our on-ground works that LLS conduct to have those works monitored, so we know that our works are actually leading to some kind of improvement. So we've been able to go out, LLS, and engage landholders and implement on-ground works, and DeepHire have been able to come behind us and monitor all those works. And they'll hopefully be able to do that over the long period, so we'll be able to see changes in water quality, in vegetation, in salt marsh condition improve, and then again go back to community and show them those results.
I believe it's worth it, yeah, because I want my kids to grow up in a nice environment and be able to just go out and get a feed whenever they want. You don't need money when you know how to catch your own food.
Yeah, it just needs to be looked after. And I'm only learning about it from the study that's going on now about what happens and what happens over time and what we can do and what the government's doing to help keep it healthy and alive, basically. We don't want a dead, smelly lake.
Everybody's happy. It's a win-win situation, this one. And in 2 years, in 5 years' time, we're going to see massive changes in that creek and the surrounding area, simply because of what we've done, and then the planting, and then what we'll continue to do after that.